Thank you so much. Thank you, doctors, and thank you to the Gajah Mada University for organizing the first national forum on health philanthropy. Thanks for inviting me for this panel discussion. Good morning to all from the Gates Foundation. I hope you know all of you are doing well and staying safe during these unprecedented times. We discussed with the organizers and with the university and felt that it would be best for my presentation largely cover four areas. First, what is the burden of disease? What is the overall philanthropic landscape in healthcare? Third, what is the Gates Foundation doing in healthcare overall? And fourth, what's been our COVID response? Can you move to the next slide? Thank you. So I think everyone is aware that there is a high burden of disease across sub-Saharan Africa and then in South and Southeast Asia. I'll explain this using DALYs, which is basically disability adjusted life years. It's a sum of mortality and morbidity and is referred to as the burden of disease. For example, if 55.9 million people died in 2017, if we sum up all of these life years lost due to death, it is the sum of difference between each person's age and their life expectancy. So we find that the world population lost about 1.65 billion years of potential life due to premature life death in that year. Most countries across these regions you will see have DALY losses of 25,000 per 100,000 individuals. And in the worst off regions, and particularly in sub-Saharan Africa, the rate is more than 80,000 DALYs per 100,000 population. While the rates in Europe and North America, in contrast, are typically greater than 10 times lower at 2,500 per 100,000. Can you move to the next slide, please? Thank you. So we are seeing this dual burden of disease across, across both parts of the developing world and the developed world. So more than half of the deaths in low-income countries in 2016 were caused by the so-called, group I conditions, which include communicable diseases, maternal causes, conditions due to pregnancy and childbirth, and nutritional deficiencies. By contrast, less than 7% of the deaths in high-income countries were due to these diseases. Lower respiratory infections were also among the leading causes of deaths among all groups. While non-communicable diseases now, cancer, diabetes, etc., are causing 71% of deaths globally, ranging from 37% in low-income countries to 88% in high-income countries. And all but one of the 10 leading causes of death in high-income countries is actually NCDs now. And in absolute number of deaths, 78% of global NCDs occurred in low- and middle-income countries. Next slide. So we've tried to analyze and look at what's actually from a philanthropic perspective, what has been the giving by the sector overall. So I do want to call out a caveat that the data is really weak in regard to how much philanthropic dollars flow to international and health and development. So it's hard to get an accurate picture. And this data is specific to the foundations and does not capture individual retail giving, which some of us might be contributing to informally. We're seeing that almost three quarters of the foundation giving, which is about 74%, in 2013 to 2015, was supported activities in social infrastructure and services such as health, education, human rights. And the remaining 26% was among the production sectors, more like agriculture. And it also shows that the BMGF commitments were highly concentrated in health and reproductive health and agriculture. And giving from other foundations was more evenly distributed among a range of sectors, including education, civil society, environment. Can you move to the next slide, please. So what is the giving by region? Again, this is coming back to the OECD data. So between 2013 and 2015, approximately 60% of the health-related giving had a global scope. So that means particularly that the work was doing from a global perspective. So it's R&D, which could be happening any part of the world, but it's allocated and, the outcome will be used by the world across, different countries. So it hasn't been allocated to that specific country, but it mainly reflects the global or the multi-regional character of many of these activities. Africa at about 24% and Asia at 13% have been the most targeted regions for country region specific activities. This also happens because some of the foundations, the larger ones, are based in the global north, and you know they are doing R&D based in these countries, but you know the outcome of these research and development is actually distributed across the world. But Africa and Asia continue to get most of the allocations from a funding perspective. Can you go to the next slide? So the global giving to health issues, which is quite prevalent and quite important in currently these times, about 7.9 billion, and about 62% of the total giving for health and reproductive health sectors was dedicated towards mostly infectious disease control. And this was followed by reproductive health and family planning, nutrition at 5%, basic healthcare infrastructure at about 3%, research at 3%, which can further grow. There's a huge scope to grow, the work in R&D space, and health education was roughly about 2%. Next slide. Which foundation are supporting global health? Pretty much, you see that the Gates Foundation has been one of the major players in this area, accounting for 72% of the giving to health. While the other seven foundations have also provided more than 100 million each for health over the period, which is the Susan Thompson Buffett Foundation from Warren Buffett's order. There is the Child Investment Foundation, the Children Investment Foundation, the Wellcome Trust, Bloomberg Philanthropies, the Carlos Slim Foundation, and the Hewlett Foundation. So more than 50 foundations dedicated more than 20% of their giving to the healthcare sector. At this point, I also want to call out, that the Indonesian foundations also have a rich history of working in the health space. And we've had the privilege as Gates Foundation, to be partnering with both Dr. Tahir Foundation and the Tahia Foundation. Dr. Tahir's foundation has also provided gifts to the university, and the partnership with, Professor Dr. Tahir proves how you can actually, in our case, how you can further advance global health priorities in partnership. He's been a critical advocate for increased services for tuberculosis, access to family planning, and introduction of critical vaccines for children. He also founded the Indonesian Health Fund, which was launched in 2014 and comprised of 8 donors that granted over $10 million to family planning and TB R&D and capacity building efforts. We've also had the fortune of partnering and collaborating with the Tahia Foundation, which is an exemplar of innovative philanthropy. Through their, their partnership with your university, with the Gajamara University, they significantly advanced the work on dengue control through the Wolbachia-infected mosquitoes. Most recently, they've been again working, with the university labs to ensure COVID-19 testing is really ramped up. While there is also the Foundation for Mother and Child Health in Indonesia, and there's the William and Lily Foundation, at the Gates Foundation, we really look forward and are really privileged to partner, with the Indonesian foundations, and we look forward to strengthening our partnership and deepening our partnership to advance, our shared goals. Could you move to the next slide, please? So I'll move to the third section and talk a little bit about what's been the scope of Gates Foundation's work overall. So we work across a broad, range of issues, but all of them focus on, removing the barriers and prevent people from living healthy and productive life. Our overall vision is that all lives have equal value. For more than 20 years, we've learned several valuable lessons about how to tackle inequity as, the Gates Foundation, and our approach continues to evolve, based on evidence and changing circumstances and situations facing the world. We're facing one of the biggest crises currently. I'll highlight four numbers. There are a lot of numbers on these slides, but I'll highlight four numbers, which I think are important. So one is the program strategy. So we work in about 38 areas, and this travels from, health and development. Our direct support every year has been roughly in the range of about $5 billion. We serve about 138 countries overall, but a large proportion of that is in, like I said before, in in South and Southeast Asia and in Sub-Saharan Africa. And we work with more than 1,000 partners across the world who are actually the bedrock, of all the impact, all the impact that we've been to have across the world. Could you move to the next slide, please? So what's our overall funding summary? So we work across 6 divisions. One is the global development, which includes our areas like family planning, maternal child health, nutrition, vaccines. Then there is the global health. So this is more of the upstream work that we do in the global health area. So around malaria, tuberculosis, pneumococcal, and a lot of the R&D work across different health areas happens in this division. Then we have the global growth and opportunity, which is largely our production area, which is agriculture, sanitation, and financial services. We also work in education, but that's primarily limited to the US. We have a very small global education team now, and we've started doing some work in India. But apart from that, our work in the global in the education space is largely restricted to the US. We work also on issues of global policy. And then you don't see gender on this side, but that's one of the newest areas that we've also started to work on, which will become one of the critical areas of the foundation. So gender equality is something that the foundation is going to really ramp up and really work on through the years. And in 2018, we invested, like I said before, roughly about $5 billion across areas such as malaria, HIV, TB, vaccines, maternal child health, nutrition, agriculture. And you can see that approximately 60 to 65% of our funding, so which is both global development and global health, is primarily going towards healthcare. Could you move to the next slide? So this slide basically just gives you a snapshot of the division, the kind of a breakup of those divisions. So as I mentioned before, most of our work is in health and spans areas such as family planning, nutrition, maternal child health, malaria, neglected tropical diseases, diarrheal diseases, pneumonia, HIV, etc. And we also work in some of the other areas. But you'll see on the left side, which is the major healthcare areas in which we are largely as a foundation prevalent and working on. Could you move to the next slide? So finally, I'll speak briefly, on our COVID response, one of the unprecedented times that, we are living in. And we've been, working on the pandemic since January, where, we got a sense of what was coming. I won't go into the number of cases out of that because I think we all know those. They're increasing, exponentially the day by day. And I really hope, we're able to bring it under control. The results from the Oxford vaccine last night were quite positive, and we have our fingers crossed as the trials progress that, we're able to get the vaccine out and also distribute it equitably across the world. You would have heard and read maybe that, Bill and Melinda both have been really worried about the pandemic for a long time. And, along with others, have been funding pandemic and epidemic preparedness, for many years, because I mentioned before we do, a lot of our work is actually in the healthcare space. So we've been laying down some of these efforts to make sure that, as a mankind, we are working and trying to control, an impact from a health perspective. And so before even COVID-19 was a pandemic, the Gates Foundation was, started supporting our work in China on R&D and other efforts to spread, to stem the spread of the disease. Largely, we also have an office in China, and that's where, we were able to see what's happening, at the forefront. And that's when we really accelerated and stepped up our efforts. So we're looking at both, both at both best potential ways to combine our expertise as a foundation and also our resources to make a difference. Globally, our earliest priorities, have been in research and development, in vaccines, in therapeutics and diagnostics to strengthen the system and capacity to respond. And taken together, roughly now most of our work has been focused on countries in Africa and South and Southeast Asia. Developing and delivering treatments and vaccines and accelerating detection and containment of the virus and trying to protect the most vulnerable communities across the world. As soon as we started realizing that this was turning into a pandemic, we started supporting, specifically these countries. and starting strengthening the health systems across both sub-Saharan Africa and South Asia, because the burden on the health system has been large and has been unprecedented, for the lower and middle income countries to actually support and withstand. At the Gates Foundation, we've now roughly committed about $300 million for our efforts on COVID-19 globally. And we are working closely with various national governments, various other philanthropic foundations, and the private sector across the globe, to fight the pandemic. And in Southeast Asia, we're working with, in primarily India, Nepal, Bangladesh, Pakistan, and also in Indonesia. We are partnering very closely and working with the World Bank to provide technical assistance for their large loan to the government of Indonesia. Our foundation, as you see on the slide, has laid out a multi-pronged strategy and primarily focusing on four goals. The first one is to protect the most vulnerable. Second is to accelerate detection and containment of the virus. Third, and probably the most important right now, is to develop treatment and, a vaccine, and also to minimize the societal and economic impact, which is also one of which we are seeing happening across from a food perspective, nutrition perspective, and health perspective across the world. Could you move to the next slide, please? So our mantra, is roughly is test, treat, and prevent. These three have kind of function as a continuum. Most on the test side, you will see we've been working with multiple partners for this. And actually, we had set up something which is called as FIND, which is the Foundation for Innovative Diagnostics, in 2003 to facilitate the development and evaluation and implementation of diagnostic tests. From a treatment perspective, in partnership with the Wellcome Trust, the MasterCard Foundation, and now we've also joined by the Dell Foundation, Chan Zuckerberg Foundation, Elma Philanthropies, we launched a therapeutics accelerator, which is primarily assessing, pharmaceutical companies to understand whether existing therapies, drugs, or drug combinations can be repurposed. So they were trying to do research on the HCQ, which came out, the dexamethasone, and the other treatments that we are seeing across the world. It's good, but not good enough, because our work continues to be at a rapid pace. Bill and the foundation working hard and is hyper-focused and to make sure that the development of low-cost vaccines for COVID-19. Go to the next slide. So finally, I'll just close by saying that for prevention, we are working closely to develop a vaccine, and we have launched institutions in the past, such as the Coalition of Epidemic Preparedness, again in partnership with various governments and philanthropies in 2016, to help develop a vaccine, so which is now called as CEPI. Some of you would have heard about it. Is leading that, the efforts on to develop a vaccine. Then we also founded something which is called as GAVI, the Global Alliance for Vaccine Introduction, which is for financing of vaccines. And then institutions in partnership with several governments, the WHO, the philanthropic foundations, are playing a critical role for development, financing, and distribution of a vaccine under the overall ACT accelerator, which is basically the access to COVID-19 tools effort that is being anchored at the G20, the AU, the APEC, the WHO, and the World Bank. So CEPI, GAVI, WHO, and others, really working to make sure that the vaccine is also out there, the financing is happened, and it's also distributed equitably across the world, because, getting a vaccine is one, but making sure that it reaches everyone across the world is, the most important. And then I'll just close by saying that, we are working with everyone to fight this COVID-19 together. And, we are trying to make sure that not only the vaccine is not only found at the earliest, but it is also, available to everyone across the world. Thank you so much again. And I hope I'm happy and to answer any questions at the end. Thank you.